Hey there, future college students. My name is Kevin Landry, and I'm from the Extra Point ACT Prep Company. Now, this is the second video in our series of the most common ACT math questions from the pre-algebra section. For this video, we're going to focus on order of operations and ordering questions. But before we get started on that, do me a quick favor and just hit the subscribe button and hit the bell notification to be updated on any new videos that are uploaded during the week. Okay, so this video is going to focus on good old-fashioned PEMDAS and ordering questions from least to greatest or greatest to least. Now, these types of questions show up pretty regularly in the first 15 questions and would be considered some of the easiest questions on the test. It's very important that you strive to get 100% of these questions correct. You definitely don't want to lose any ground on your score for these easier question types. What I'd like you to do is go down in the description below and look for the link for the notes. Print the notes and spend about 5 minutes working the questions. Once you finish working the questions, come back and watch the remainder of the video for explanations. And in those explanations, I'll tend to give you good strategies for doing some of these math questions quicker or more efficiently. And if you don't know how to work the questions, I might give you some strategies of how to back your way into an answer or two. All right, good luck on these, and I'll see you at the end of the video. Okay, now we next jump into our next type of common pre-algebra questions, and these are order of operations questions. Now, a lot of students, when they think pre-algebra and they think order of operations, they think of the term PEMDAS, representing the order in which you actually do something, parentheses, then exponents, multiplication, division, addition, subtraction. But not all ACT questions are necessarily PEMDAS questions. They may be actually ordering some numbers from least to greatest or doing various other types of problems that have something to do in and around the ordering of numbers or the order of the operations of a problem. That being said, your most common problem is your ability to use your calculator, your ability to evaluate expressions, and we'll get into those terms in just a second. So let's go here to the first problem. Again, if you have not done this and you just kind of stumbled onto this video, the way this playlist kind of works is I provide you a document with roughly 5 to 6 practice questions from a very specific topic area from the ACT, and the best thing for you to do is to actually print that document. Give yourself 5 minutes, work the questions, hopefully in less than 5 minutes, and then come back to this video and listen to the explanations and the coaching that I give, the test prep skills that I suggest, and things of that nature. So you can kind of get prepped for the whole ACT if you just follow my common ACT question playlist, if you want to do that way. We know that in all the years that we've prepped students, all the other videos that I make and all the other videos that you can find out there on YouTube, they're great. They give you wonderful tips. But in the end, you're going to have to practice all this stuff. And that's what these playlists are geared towards. So let's jump into it here. I'm going to go to this first question. It says, what is the value of the expression? And there's a whole bunch of stuff there, right? Kind of making your eyes cross. You got some absolute value. You got some exponents. You got some division, multiplication, old school X's for the multiplication. Sometimes the ACT will use the little dot for multiplication, so make sure you understand that as well. Now, in an ideal testing world, what I would hope that you would be able to do in this scenario is to put all of this in your calculator at once. Now, if you are doing that and you're getting wrong answers, then that means you need to practice some calculator skills. Now, for this particular problem, there's quite a lot going on. Some of you may have more advanced calculators than others. So if you're using something like a TI Inspire calculator, it would be very easy to put this in all in one entry line. And the reason is because it gives you visual feedback. You can see, do I have this looking exactly like what's the question on the ACT? If you have a TI 84 plus, you get a similar visual feedback. It's closer to the TI Inspire. However, if you just have an old TI 84 or a TI 83, you may not get that visual feedback. So you have to make sure you use your parentheses very well. if you're using a scientific calculator that only has one line, maybe two entry lines, you're definitely not going to see the entry into your calculator look exactly like what's on your test paper. So you have to kind of make the decision. Do I know how to do this? Am I confident in my calculator skills? Now, if you are not confident in your calculator skills, here's what I would suggest. Do the top parts first. So actually get a number for the top part. And if you have to do this in pieces, that's fine. And if you did that, if you did the absolute value of, you know, negative 3 minus 2, and then you squared it, and then you added it to negative 1, you would end up with 24 in the numerator. And then we're going to work on the bottom parts. And then if you did the order of operations there, you should end up with 3. And then it makes it really easy to come up with the correct answer of 8, which is choice E. Now, if you're punching this in and you don't have a TI-84 plus or TI Inspire, make sure that you understand that that fraction bar is really kind of throwing parentheses around the tops and the bottoms, or the numerators and the denominators, so that you do those as separate operations. So anyway, what I would like to see you do is, now that you know what the answer is, play with your calculator and see how much of that you can get into your calculator in one entry line and still come up with the correct answer. So give yourself some, you know, some confidence in your skills by verifying that you are doing this correctly. But again, you'll see a question like this pretty early on in the ACT math test, and you got to nail it. Okay, next question. What is the value of negative x squared minus a negative x when x equals to negative 2? Now, I'm going to be real frank with you. This is an order of operations question, but this is also an Algebra 1 question where we evaluate expressions. Now, evaluating expressions are finding the value of an expression. So a lot of y'all have heard the word evaluate or seen it in the directions of given various math tests. The root word there is value, and that means, evaluate means to find the value of. So in order to find that value of an algebraic expression that has variables in it, we need to replace that variable with a given number. So a lot of students will immediately kind of connect the idea of evaluating an expression with substitution. And even though those two are linked at the hip, they're not technically the exact same definition, but we are going to use substitution into the algebraic expression so that we can then find the value of the new numerical expression. Now, here's the really tricky part about this. Notice that you have a negative number, x equals to negative 2. I'm going to recommend anytime you substitute, you absolutely need to use parentheses. So put that negative 2 in parentheses everywhere so that you don't make a mistake with negatives or exponents. So let's go ahead and substitute the negative 2 in for all of the x values. It should look something like this. Okay, and you can see every place that there was an x, I put a negative 2 in parentheses in the given expression. Now that I have numbers everywhere, I can find the value of this. And so again, it's just like the previous problem. Hopefully you should be able to put this into your calculator all in one entry line. That's going to save you valuable seconds on a time test like the ACT math section. If you cannot, just make sure you put it in correctly and verify that you get it 100%. Right. So let's go ahead and see what this turns out to be. So you can see that we got positive 2 as an answer, and so that would be answer choice D. And if you notice, they also have the negative version, negative 2. So if you made a negative sign mistake, an error somewhere, that could potentially give you a bad answer. All right, the next question is a very popular ACT type question. The PEMDAS rule, or the order of operations that most students learn, include the distributive property. So eliminating parentheses through the distributive property. Now, in this particular question, they've kind of thrown in an extra set of parentheses that are kind of unnecessary. So if we look at this, if we look at the parentheses around C minus D, we are actually adding that. So, I mean, if you distributed a positive 1, you're just going to get C minus D. So it's really more of a question that should be written like this. And it really doesn't change the question any. So now we do have an A outside of the brackets here that are serving as a grouping symbol. So parentheses in PEMDAS really could be replaced with the idea of grouping symbols. And so we're going to distribute A to every part of this. And so we're going to get A times B plus A times C minus A times D. And then we just look for the answer that matches up. Now, I want you to notice, just from an answer choice standpoint, you should have known that AB was going to be correct at some point. But if we were doing process of elimination, we know that we got AC. We could have immediately eliminated D and E from this particular set because it just had C and D in it and not the AC and the AD. So we're looking for the correct one. And in this particular case, A is the correct answer choice. All right, this next question is more of an ordering question, not order of operations question. And the biggest clue or the biggest tip that I could give you on working problems of this nature are when they give you a bunch of numbers that are written in different formats, either they're fractions, they're decimals, they're radicals, you want to put them all in the same format. And the format that I think is the easiest for you to get to is decimals. So what I would do here is I would convert everything to a decimal and bring the decimal points out to the same place value so that you can actually compare them. So I'm gonna do that real quick. Okay, so you can see I've kind of converted everything from the given format to a decimal going out roughly six decimal places or six place values after the decimal. This way, that'll give me an obvious comparison. So obviously, 1.08 is smaller than 1.8. So these two are clearly going to be smaller than these two on top. Now, it says to put the numbers in ascending order. If the word ascending fakes you out, if you're unsure, you can use the actual answers to help you out. Notice that they're using less than signs. So we're going from smallest to largest here in the order for us to go in ascending order. So if we're looking at the two sets of numbers, I can actually kind of group them off in this way. I know that these are smaller and these are larger, so I have to just figure out within those groups which one is first. And so we can see in the smaller group, because that's what we're going to be looking for, 1.08000 is going to be smaller than 1.0808 because of this term or this place value right here. That one makes it that 8 makes it a little bit bigger. Not a lot bigger, but a little bit bigger. So we're going to start off with 1.08 as the first one and then 1.08 repeating as the second one. So if we just look at our answer choices, what that does is that really narrows us down to either D or E. So I can immediately eliminate A, B, and C very quickly. And then I just have to choose between our larger numbers. 1.80 and 1.88, clearly that place right there, that 8 is larger than that 0. So the 1.8 repeating is the largest number, put 9/5 in the middle there. And so that gives us answer choice E as the correct answer choice. The ACT loves problems like this. I'm not saying you're going to get one like this on every single ACT math test that you take, but if you took the test 7 times over the course of the year, you'd probably see this question 3, maybe 4 times. So definitely understand the strategy of how to do this and how to do this quickly. A lot of the stuff that I'm saying and talking out loud and writing down is just for your benefit to hear my thought process. This clearly would not take me 1, 2, 3 minutes to do a problem like this, even though it's taken me that long to explain some of these problems. So remember, this will go through your head and go through your calculator a lot faster than my explanation. All right, let's move on to the last problem in this practice set. For 0 is less than or equal to t, which is less than or equal to 19, the motion of a particle can be modeled, popular questions in the ACT modeling, can be modeled by the function s of t equals negative t squared plus 9t, where s is the height and t equals time in seconds. What is the official height, that's the s, of the particle when the t equals 4 seconds? So when the t equals 4 seconds, what that basically means is when t equals to 4, we want to replace all the t values with a 4. So this is a substitution problem, or a fancier form of the evaluation problem that we did in the second problem earlier in this video. So I'm going to replace t with the 4, And again, remember I said it's a good idea to use parentheses anytime you replace these. Now, PEMDAS says parentheses then exponents. And this is a little tricky. A lot of students will see the parentheses around the 4 and think that they have to do the negation of the 4 first because it's got parentheses and they want to get rid of it. That's not what we mean when we say parentheses. If there's an actual operation embedded inside the parentheses, we want to do that first. 4 has been simplified inside the parentheses, so there's nothing to do there. So we're going to go ahead and square that first. So that's going to leave us negative 16, and of course we're going to multiply the 9 and the 4 to make this a little quicker. And then this is going to equal to 20. And since we're dealing in feet, since we're dealing with the height, it's going to be 20 feet tall, 20 feet high. So that is answer choice D. All right, so that was hopefully a good practice set for you on some basic ordering or order of operations problems that are very common on the ACT portion involving pre-algebra. So I hope you'll take the time now to move on in the playlist and continue to work these practice problems. If you need any other additional ACT tips, be sure to check out some of our other videos and check out our other playlist. If you have trouble with Algebra 1 or Geometry, we'll have other playlists available with practice problems for those as well. So good luck on your next ACT. All right, so did you find that one pretty easy? So let me know in the comments below which particular ACT math problems give you the most trouble, and we'll be sure to make a video on that particular topic or topics for you in the near future. Thanks for watching this video, and be sure to keep an eye out for the remainder of the videos in this series. Remember, the quickest way to improvement on the ACT is to practice as many questions as you can. If you need additional practice questions, we have a very good ACT online prep course that has over 2,000 practice questions, along with strategies to help you improve on the ACT. Be sure to check that out. I provided you with a link in the description below, and we look forward to helping you out with your ACT needs. Don't forget, we also have plenty of free resources on our website. Be sure to check those out as well. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next video.